Good morning to you all, and you're welcome to another episode of the Surviving COVID-19 series, which today is focusing on the much younger generation who find themselves caught up in a strange world as a result of the coronavirus pandemic. It's very easy to be so worried about the impact of the pandemic on our lives, and we tend to forget that the children of this world may be having their own challenges, processing and comprehending all that's going on around them. Despite being mature as adults, many of us couldn't come to terms with the restrictions imposed by the state. So you can imagine what the children who typically are free at heart and should be enjoying their lives playing and having fun are going through being locked down all these months. Now, how much of the policy decisions which impact them involve them? Do they understand why they haven't been to school all these months and why and when they can return to school and meet and play with their friends? How long will they have to sit behind a computer for phone lessons for those who are privileged enough to have that? And how about those who don't have access to online learning because their school is not that endowed? Are there psychological implications for the children being confined all this while? And what can they do to keep safe and sane? These are some of the questions I am hoping we can answer this morning. The conversation will be mainly about the children. So I've brought together some of the brightest and best, accompanied by their parents. From Kumasi, we have Angel Saah, Prempeh of Hilltop School, shadowed by her mom, Flora Arthur.
Hello.
Hey.
Hiya, Flora. Okay, so thanks for joining us. We have Ange Atete. She attends Kigali International Community School, and she's with her mom, Jenipher Ingabire. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Israel.
Yes. Great to have you on board.
Happy to be with you too.
All right. And then we also have from London, we have my niece, Christabel Nelson, from Greenshaw High School, and her mom, who's my sister, Dorcas. Hello.
Hello.
Okay, great. So we also have joining us our superstar, DJ Switch. DJ Switch, please introduce yourselves and tell us all who you are.
Hi, my name is Katando, popularly known as DJ Switch Ghana. I'm 12 years old and I'm a DJ, yeah.
Okay, so thank you for joining us. And you've been around the world, and I'm sure, had it not been for COVID, you probably would be meeting with some presidents or something.
Yeah.
All right, great. We have a few others who are going to be joining. So as they join, I will introduce them. Now we have Dr. Mrs. Sandra Thompson-Assan. So Dr. Sandra, can we have you introduce yourself too?
Hi, as mentioned already, I'm Dr. Mrs. Sandra Thompson-Assan. I'm a counselor and a research psychologist, and currently the well-being counselor and psychology teacher at Tema International School. I'm a mother of two and a wife.
All right, so let's get on with the conversation. Let's start the conversation, and then somewhere along the line, if the line is clearer, we can get to hear them. Okay, so I want you all to tell us, first of all, what you understand by this coronavirus. I'm going to start with you, Christabel.
That I understand that it's a global pandemic that's affecting everyone in the world. And it has killed many people.
Is it, how bad is it in London?
It's been very bad.
But I guess it's getting better now, right?
Yeah, it's slowly getting better.
Do you know anyone who has COVID? Any of your friends or your friends' parents?
Yes, I do.
And what was it like?
My sister's friend's father passed away, sadly.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and he lived opposite us. So.
Oh, really? That's so sad.
Mm-hmm.
That's so sad. Sorry about how old?
mid-50s. Yeah.
Okay, so quite old. Sorry about that. DJ Switch, do you know anybody who has had COVID?
No.
Okay, but I'm sure you've heard about it. What do you make of it?
Come again?
What do you make of COVID-19 and the way it's impacted the world?
Well, I think COVID-19, the infectious disease, is very is infecting a lot. Like the number of cases being recorded every single day, the number of deaths that we have every single day. I mean, it's very bad, and it's affecting the children even more. Not also infecting us in schools and leaving our parents in the house in fear. So I think it's very bad.
Now, Prince, how about you? How has COVID-19, the pandemic, affected you?
It's caused a lot of chaos. And for me as a child, I see COVID-19 to be something that's going to change certain things in our lives. Yeah.
What are the things, some of the things that has changed for you already?
Speaking about education, now in this time, we don't go to school, but we now have to follow up with the online. Yeah, so one disadvantage is that we don't actually get more time to interact with our teachers. And it's very stressful, but we are trying our best to learn it. Because as students, that's application is what we have to do to get a better feeling.
Okay, your line is not too good. We hope that when we come back to you, it's going to be a lot better. But I want to come to you, Ange, and Jenipher from Rwanda. So, Ange, I'd want to hear from you.
Okay.
What has it been like for you as far as the pandemic is concerned?
To me, it's a very lonely process. So, being as lockdown was in Rwanda, getting out of the house, we really couldn't. We couldn't go outside of the house. But mostly as kids, because our parents were prepared for this lockdown. So we didn't. There wasn't much to worry about because we had already stocked for food, because it would be hard to go to the market during the lockdown. So it was we were very prepared for this lockdown.
What are some of the things you miss?
It was kind of the same as being at school, because we had interaction with our teachers, our friends through teams. So learning wasn't as hard as I imagined it.
Hello, Flora. So you tell us about your experience.
Okay, as a mother, it has been a challenge for us because you have to leave the house, you go to work, and your kids are in the house. And to concentrate 100% with the job that you are doing, you cannot really do it because they are in the house and you yourself, you are in the office. And also to the kids also, it's like initially when they came home, they were excited that they are staying in the house, but now you can really see that it's having a toll on them. Because living in the house, whatever program you are watching on TV, it's being repeated. So after doing your online classes, there's practically nothing to do. So it's also having a toll on them. we just hope that very soon the pandemic will end. If not, maybe a vaccine will come out so that they'll be able to return back to school.
All right, we're all hoping same. And Angel, what do you have to say about how this pandemic has affected everybody?
Well, initially, I was supposed to write the BEC in June, but because of the pandemic, it got canceled and then postponed to September. So right now, as the cases keep increasing, I'm not sure whether we'll be able to write it or not, but I really hope it comes on, because the stress is just too much. Every day you're wondering whether or not you're going to contract it, or you're going to contract, or you're going to spread it if you contract it, or whether you're going to die or not. So even as I go to school, sometimes I'm scared, because you have to treat everyone as if he or she has the virus. Therefore, you have to keep your distance.
So when you have to go out, Angel, you have to go to school, you have to put on a nose mask and keep it on all through. Is that the case?
Yes.
So during break time, what do you do?
During break, the matrons, they bring the food to the classes, to the various classes. Then they've written the name on the pack, on the packaging. So when they call out your name, then you pay for it and collect your food. Then you have to eat it in the class and then throw it away. After that, you wash your hands and sanitize it. Then you go back to your seats and then prepare for the next lesson.
So for the period that you have to eat, you'd have to take off your nose mask.
Yes.
Does it worry you that during that period you could get infected?
A little.
Okay. But as it is, there's no playing around, right?
No, not really.
Okay. Right, let me go to Mr. Liga, who's standing by with his son Desmond. Hello, Desmond. So you tell us what your experience has been too. Looks like we're having challenges with Desmond's line, but Desmond is joining us from Mataheko. He's at Mataheko 1 Basic. So hopefully, yeah, it's going to get better and it's going to join us. So Dr. Thompson Asan is also with us. Dr. Thompson Asan, I want you to tell us, you've heard the initial thoughts of the children we've had to speak with. What is your position? How have you seen this pandemic affecting children as a psychologist and an emotional well-being counselor?
All right. Thankfully, I'll say children are not fazed by the pandemic. And then to a large extent, they are spared from its direct effects. However, the challenge here is they risk being among the biggest victims. Why am I saying this? Because children would love to play. If you could recall from all that the students or children in here are saying, they lack that element of play. Children have fun when they play, they learn through play, they also interact, and in a way, they gain social support from the play. It's something that goes by blind side, but it does happen because through their interaction, most children want to share their challenges with close friends, and they in a way collect solutions from them. It's not everything they want to share with their parents. So if they lack that element of play, then it becomes problematic and it goes a long way to affect their well-being. So before I would even touch on their well-being, I would want to quickly suggest to parents that you educate children at home. Let them know what exactly the COVID is. Not necessarily you lecturing or teaching them, but have a discussion with them around it, what it is, where the outbreak first started, and they should also know how it eventually became a global pandemic. As well, you tell them the preventive measures that we are putting in place, or government is putting in place, or everyone should put in place to battle this virus. Most importantly, they need to discuss with them its effects. So for instance, if a family member is tested positive, for sure out there, there'll be stigmatization. If this child should go out, how is the child going to handle such a situation, such a reaction from friends, from family members, from neighbors, and I mean, people all over? You need to educate them. And then what I would want to stress much emphasis here in terms of its effect on family. Currently, we know what is happening. We have salaries being slashed for most companies. Others have been laid off or they have their appointment terminated, and others are also working from home. This is the time you have to sit with your children and discuss with them. I'm saying this because in the past, perhaps you were going out with every child, I mean your children on weekends or your child on weekends. And now because of the financial stress, all this sort of will get off the way. How is a child going to accept and cope with this? You need to sit with a child depending on the age. For instance, the teenagers, they are exposed to a lot, and then they can even bring ideas, valuable information on board for you to see the way forward. And also if they see you exhibit any kind of behavior, they understand. So for instance, to also families who are working from home, for your child not to feel abandoned or rejected, you need to discuss with the child. As a result of COVID, there's been impact at my workplace. I'm supposed to work between so and so time at home. Hence, you will not be seeing me around this time. Or I'll exclude myself around this time. However, when I'm done, I'll come back to you. Such a child feels that, hey, I'm not rejected and mommy or daddy sees me in there. Okay, so moving on. In fact, when you discuss such things with the children, it's really critical. I'm saying it's critical because as I mentioned to you, and if I encountered a lot, they discuss a lot among themselves. They make phone calls, they make video calls, they discuss a lot. A child, I have a friend in South Africa whose son is 7 years. A child is one who is educating the parents in terms of statistics around COVID. So the question is that, are you going to ignore such a child? No, bring the child on board. He or she is going to even educate you and you now become well informed about certain things you never knew. All right, towards your well-being. Now, because of the absence of play, and even before that, let me quickly put across exactly what well-being is.
Right.
So well-being has to do with the state of being comfortable, healthy, and happy. Similarly, it's also the state of being psychologically, mentally, emotionally, socially, and academically sound. And children attain their complete well-being through play, like I said earlier on. So now the issue is, if such a child is deprived, not necessarily deprived, as a result of a vital measure or a necessary measure that should be taken for the closure of school, and such a child is no longer having or seeing friends to play with, it has a psychological effect. It begins to affect their well-being to a larger extent. And then they begin to get worried. They show signs of anxiety. And then they also exhibit fear here. Now, to further or to delve deep into this well-being issue, I would want to also classify children here. And then okay. I'll borrow...
Before we come to classifying them, I'd want to get their thoughts on... whether they think or what they've been, let's start off with the online schooling. Those who are taking part in online schooling, not everybody is taking part in online schooling. And indeed, I would want to go to Desmond. Desmond has been able to join us now with a father. I want to go to Desmond. Desmond is at Mataheko Basic, Mataheko 1 Basic School. And he certainly would have some thoughts. Thank you very much, James, for finally succeeding in joining us. I want to speak with Desmond. Desmond, how are you able to benefit from schooling now that you're staying at home all through? How are you educating yourself? You know. We're having challenges with his connection. All right, I want to come to you. Let's come to you, Prince. So Prince, what is it like? How do you find online schooling? You'd have to unmute your microphone. Hello, Prince.
Hello.
Yes, let's hear you now. But let's see your video as well.
Challenges with this connection. All right, I want to come to you.
Yes, Uncle.
Yes. You can speak, but we've lost your video, so turn on your video.
Okay. About the online classes. Okay, it's very comfortable, but I like the fact that we're able to interact with our teachers, even though we are not actually in school. And it gives us more time to actually work by ourselves, because the time we use for the online classes is more shorter than the time we use at school in normal times. So I see it as an opportunity to like do things on my own, to be actually independent. Yeah, so it's really helping me.
Okay, how about you, DJ Switch? Are you taking part in online classes, and how are you finding it?
Yeah, I take part in the online classes, and I think that it's a very good occasion that has been placed that for with the students at home to also get to talk to our teachers and our friends. And I think it's very good, although now that our brothers and sisters are about to write BC, the teachers also go to school and teach them, and we're the ones who are not writing the BC are in the house waiting for the line to come and teach us. It's with a little time, but it's good. It teaches us a lot. And talking about being given work to do in the house, I think it's good, but the teacher's not in the house to see if you are not on there to search for what for the answer of the question being given to you. So it's good and also bad, you know. Everything has an advantage and disadvantage.
No, DJ Switch, I want to hear more about that. Are you saying that you attempted to cheat?
Not I attempted to cheat, but it's normal, because even sometimes when we are being given work, one of my friends will be like, "Sir, are we allowed to use the internet, or we should just do it on my brain?" And then the teacher is not there to see if you are answering the questions from your brain. It happens.
Okay. All right. Let's go to you. Christabel, are you had the opportunity to attend school for a while because schools were reopened. How was it when you had to go back to school?
Online school has definitely been more difficult than I expected. I thought it would be a little bit easier because we're at home, we're comfortable in our own homes, but it's definitely been harder, especially with concentration as well and having siblings in the house.
What about the siblings? But they're also supposed to be taking part in online classes.
Yeah, a lot. yes, but it's been difficult because if they don't want to do the work, they don't really have to, because the teacher's not there to, you know, encourage them to do it, and mom's not at home, she's at work. So me trying to help them to do their work has been difficult.
Okay. Let's come to you, Ange. What has online classes been, online learning been like for you?
I'm the oldest out of three kids, and having to work with the youngest sister running around and screaming most of the time is distracting. So it's also been a little bit easier for me because I feel relaxed, not nervous, and not really anxious because I'm at home, and it's been a win-win because I have the advantage to speak to my teacher and also speak to my friends. So it's been a good experience.
Okay, let me come to you, Angel, the other Angel we have here. Angel, are you eager, or would you want to go back to school anytime soon?
During the online classes, the teachers did their very best to make it feel as if we were in a real classroom. They interacted with us and they helped to explain that this did not understand. And upon returning to school, we've been able to brush on some of the topics we've learned during the online classes, and we've been able to continue them and to continue them.
Okay, let me go to Desmond. Desmond, hopefully your line is going to be a lot better now. So Desmond, you haven't had the opportunity to speak at all because the internet hasn't been kind to you. So let's now hear you. You tell us what you make of this whole pandemic, first of all.
It's a disease that's been worrying us a lot.
Okay. How has it worried you?
And it has been affecting our education. And I know that this disease is worrying us a lot. So we need to look and learn, because we are not able to go to school since this disease came. So it's affecting our education.
Do you have the benefit of online learning?
No.
Is there an opportunity? Do you watch the classes that happen on TV?
Yes.
Okay, so how are you enjoying that? Are you able to follow?
Please, the question again.
What are some of the things you've been able to pick up during the lessons? Right, Desmond is having a challenge hearing us. So let's pray he can get to resolve his challenges, because we really want to hear from him, because he's the one who doesn't actually benefit from online classes. When you look at all that's going on, all the participants we have, essentially everybody has the benefit of online classes except Desmond. So we want to hear how it's impacting him. So whilst he works on resolving the challenges, I would want to ask all of you, would you want to be consulted in policy decisions that involve you, as in when you have to go back to school? And I want to ask that of those in Ghana especially. Did you switch?
Yeah, it would be so good, because in cases like this, we the young ones, our voices should also be heard, because we are the ones who are going back to school to go and learn. And there is a positive and negative thing about going back to school. You go back to school and then you're happy because we're going back to school, going to learn, and then continue what we're doing on the online classes. But there's also a possibility that you may be infected in the school, and it worries a lot parents, you yourself, in a whole lot of things. But I think that if our voices were also being heard about the decision of we going back to school, it would be a perfect decision. And I know that some people do not want to go back to school because they feel like they are in the house and then they are enjoying learning in the house. Those, especially those who do not engage themselves in the online classes, they have the opportunity, but they do not want to, because they know that they are in the house and there is no teacher to punish them if they did not take part in the online classes. So I think it will be good if our voices are also heard, because some of our elders pay deaf ears to what we are saying, but sometimes this is the correct thing that we say. So I think it would be good if our voices are also being heard.
What is it that you want to say that you're not being allowed to say, or you can't voice out, or nobody is listening to you?
Well, that is, I'm trying to say that in Africa, in decisions being made, it's like the leaders make decisions and we have to follow some, like, decisions about us. Something about the SDGs or something like that. Decisions that are being made about us are being made for us without our voice being listened to.
Okay, great. I want to come to you, Prince. Prince, can you tell us, is there anything that you would want to say or contribute to the conversation about the pandemic and the way the policymakers are handling it that you're not getting the opportunity to do so?
Please, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Please, can you hear me?
Okay. We can hear you.
Okay, speaking of going back to school, I don't think there are any possibilities of us going back to school, because day by day, the numbers of the infected people keep rising. But we are praying for this pandemic to leave, so that at least those, speaking of those in the villages, they don't actually have the opportunity to actually get access to our online studies, so we reopen so that everyone has wished to do. Hello.
All right. I'd want to come to you, Ange. So how about you? Do you feel that you need to make an input? You need to be allowed to make an input as to the decisions affecting as far as this pandemic is concerned.
If when decisions can be made, we could also give our opinions, because as adults, they have different lives to us kids. They might not know how we live or feel. So they don't know how we feel about this pandemic or what should be done. And it would be better for maybe everyone if they would listen to us. They would listen to our opinions on or what should be done during this pandemic.
Thank you, Jenipher. What's it like managing the children? They've been home for several months, and the kids can be quite a handful. How's it been like?
Thank you, Israel. It's not been easy to us parents. Specifically myself, I was supposed to. Not having the experience of teaching children, it's been a challenge. And of course, you have to prepare food, you have to do the housework, at the same time you have to supervise children at home with three children with different teachers, and all of them with different expectations. Sometimes the meetings would collide, like Zoom meetings or online meetings. So you'd find that it's really hard to supervise. But on the other hand, it's been an experience. We've had to understand what these teachers go through. And you've come to understand your children more, like in terms of what they know. Because most times when we send them to school, of course, you come and do the homework. Once you're done with the homework, and that's all. But this time, we've gone into detail. To me, it has this positive and negative. Of course, very stressful, but also a learning experience.
All right, and how about you, Dorcas? How have you been coping with the kids, having them all at home?
It's been very tough. I have to leave early, sometimes before they wake up. So during the day, I'll have to call in to see whether they are awake or they're doing chores that I had allocated to them. And most of the time they'll still be sleeping. Sometimes nobody picks the phone. I have to keep calling. I tried to find things that they could do. So I would get baking supplies in. So if they want to cook, if they want to bake, and then I got them seedlings to plant. So we planted tomatoes, onion, and all those things. So every morning they would have a routine, get up, water the plants, and then do what needed to be done. And then I had the problem of them not logging in to the online learning at this particular time. So I keep getting phone calls, emails from the school about them not logging on. So then when I come back, I'll have to make sure Ella completes her work, because she was the one I had most problem with. The other two were okay, although they are all in secondary school. Ella is hard to manage. She loves her bed, so she wouldn't get up. She can sleep until 3 p.m. So for her, it's been difficult, and it's been difficult for me because I have to keep on top of her all the time. And it's cost me financially as well. My bills have doubled. Food, electricity, everything is through the roof. And then I get everybody asking me for pocket money to buy something or do something. So for me, it's not good. And I still don't know whether the two of them would return in September, but she's a priority because she's preparing for her GCSEs. I know. The problem is that when they go back to school, there is a policy of no mask. So I'm worried about the potential problems that could also come up.
Oh, hold on, you said there's a policy of no mask?
Yeah. When she went to school for the 2 days, she was actually doing 2 days a week, which was Monday and Tuesday from 9:15 to 12:15. And I had to sign that she wouldn't wear a mask at school, even though I had one, like she had one she could take. And the rationale was that when everybody brings in their mask, it will contaminate the environment.
All right, this sounds quite strange. That they're not supposed to wear the mask, but that's how they spread the infections.
Well, I did not understand, because I felt if they bring in a mask to school, like a new one every day, that should help. But I was made to sign that she wouldn't wear a mask whilst at school.
Is the school providing them with masks?
No, but to be fair, they had less number of people in the class. How many people?
Eight
people in a class from how many?
Like 30.
From 30 pupils in the class, they reduced it to 8. And then they had a designated area they had to be in, so you wouldn't mix with the other students. So it was like a sanitized environment.
All right. So do we know if they have actually probably fumigated the environment?
I don't know about that, but I do know they had hand sanitizing gel.
So basically, before you get into the school, they take your temperature, you sanitize, you get into a line, everybody's 2 meters apart, and then you go into the classroom. Everybody has their designated desk, and you don't move till it's time to go home.
Oh, so then for how long do you have to sit in your desk?
The whole way through school.
So and it's about 3 hours.
Yeah.
Wow. All right, let me come to the other side. Flora, so we've heard some of the parents saying that, well, Dorcas is saying that her bills have had to double because her kids have been home. What's been your experience?
It is. For bills has actually gone up because they are in the house 24/7. TV, other gadgets are all on. And also with the online studies, if you have to, since they are in the house, you have to go to work. When it's time, you have to also call back home to find out whether they've logged on. For I have two girls. The one in JHS one, I don't have any issue. Hey. By my abled angel here, you have to be on her to be able to sign on in. And also the security aspect of it. You leave the gadgets on them. For me personally, I've set the Google security. In as much as she's 14, I set it at age 7. But I don't know of other parents. Leaving the gadgets with them, internet is on. If you don't take care, you don't even really know the website they are going to and other things. So all these things gives you that chill that is it really the that is something about the online thing that personally I wasn't feeling comfortable with it. But and teenagers will always be teenagers. At times you come back, you give them chores to do. At times you come back, everything is in good position, everything has been done well. Other times you come back from work, and if you don't take care, you are going to cry. But all you know, there's also a positive aspect of it for them being in the house. Because as parents as we are, and as busy as we are, schedules were, at first you wake up in the morning, everybody is rushing, they are going to school, you are going to work. You come back home, you are so tired. And they are already also tired. So you don't really have that interaction with them. But with this lockdown that came in, at least we have a bit of time to bake together, to cook together. And now if I'm in the office and I call that I want to come home and I want to eat this, you come and they're able to prepare it for you. So that is also the positive aspect of it for me.
All right, that's great. Patricia, are you also enjoying them and having them cook for you like it's happening in the case of?
Okay, the first and the second, they are boys, but I've taught them how to cook, maybe rice, prepare some banku and stuff. So as they are in the house, maybe if it is time for them to eat, they will prepare it themselves. And one thing is, if they go to school, you know, as for this, they are in school, so you can go out and have your other chores. Because you know, you get home before they come around. By this time, they are all in the house. Maybe you have to get them.
Well, it's a shame. The connection, Patricia, connection is not, it's not really good. I'll come back to you, Patricia. DJ Switch, are you giving your mom a lot
so
of hassle?
We are all praying that everything will be fine, everything will be clear, so that the children, because this thing to
okay, we've lost you, Patricia. So DJ Switch, are you giving your mom a lot of hassle?
Well, we are 5 kids. I'm the second born, the only girl. 4 brothers, and it's very tough with twins. It's very difficult because sometimes when you need to go online for online classes and you have Zoom meetings, that they will make a lot of things, they won't let you concentrate. If my parents go out, my mom goes out to get goods for the house, I will be the one to take care of them since my other brother is at school. So I will have to provide everything, like water, even water that they have to drink, they will need to come and tell me before they can drink it. So being on online classes, Zoom, and like, Erica, I want to drink water, shouting and all this stuff, not making you concentrate. And I think that my parents also, it causes a lot of money, bills and stuff, because my brother's playing game, turning on this television, turning on television in this room and in that room, playing game in that room. I mean, it increases the bill that my parents need to pay. And also, one most important thing is that with internet connection, it's very difficult for our parents to get internet connection for all five of us, and also the all five of us. So sometimes I want to finish and hand over my device to my brothers, and that will even keep them from sometimes getting to log into their classes. And I think it's difficult for our parents to sometimes cope with us doing online classes.
So essentially, you mean you don't have enough devices for everybody?
Yeah, because my parents have their devices where they talk to their friends and stuff. They also have jobs to do, so they use their devices. We have laptops, but you know, five children. How many devices do you have for five kids? And then the internet connection for all the five devices you give to all the kids is very stressful.
All right.
Cost a lot.
Yeah. It certainly will cost a lot. And I know about that. I mean, right here in my home. So let me go to Dr. Sandra. Dr. Sandra, we've heard some of the challenges that they've talked about and the cost implications of having all the kids being at home, a lot of food and all that. But we also heard some of the parents talk about how it's enabled them bond a lot better with their kids. So certainly there's been some positives to all of this.
I'll say the current challenge we're facing has its own ups and then the disadvantages. And then I was excited when the parents said at this point they've benefited from bonding with the kids. Attachment is very essential for the children in future. Children who usually will go away world, especially, or children who would want to or are not stable in their relationship. It's been said in articles, series of articles, you can check Ainsworth if you have the time, that attachment is very key in adult relationship. So at this point, if you begin to bond with a child, if you begin to communicate with a child, if you begin to share insight with a child, this child begins to learn from you, because it's also an observation period. They learn from you, and in future they replicate same. Absence of this affects their future. And then in terms of the negative, yes, when I was listening, I was just thinking about one aspect. There is this image that was circulating on Facebook. I don't know if you came across it. It says that, "I'm not against online learning, but what about us?" Okay, so it goes back to what I was trying to lay hands on in terms of disparities. Okay, we have what we call, according to Prof. Johnson, we have what we call the minority privileged, and then we have the majority poor. Okay, so I can see most of us here having access to online studies and all that. That is a good thing, although we are talking about it challenges, it's a good thing. But have you thought about the one in my village who doesn't even have electricity? Have we also thought about the fact that is it Desmond? Desmond, unfortunately, is not having access to online studies. However, he can also tune in to listen to other stations and learn alongside with them. So that's an advantage over there. The question is that what about the rest? When you come to my school, Tema International School, during the lockdown, we were not relaxed at all. We had measures in place. Students were all over doing their Zoom classes. Parents were assisting them. As low as those in the primary school had lots of projects that they were involved in to share out there in terms of the COVID. So yes, I understand it will come with its own challenges, but usually our advisor, let's look to the positives, because the positive is what will help us and enable us look to the way forward or put measures for the way forward.
All right, let me just go on to Facebook because we have some comments that have come through and I'd like to share the comments with you. So I have Ifua Mansa Sumedu just saying Mama Flora, and then we have Florence saying Auntie Pat and Prince. Gloria can come says beautiful learning experiences. Thank you. Lord Thompson says parents could consider the option of the mini cameras that connect with cell phones. That way, you are able to monitor from your smartphone the activities of your kids at home. Thank you very much, Lord. And then Kwame Apiakubi says, Israel, a major boost, you're doing well, thank you. Abdul Hakim says, my organization, Mother of All Nations Foundation, is embarking on a research related to this, so I'm really learning a lot from this program. Thank you, Mr. Israel. Sumara King says, I just love the children. They're brilliant. Yes, they are brilliant. So the kids, this from Auntie Sumara, she says, you're just brilliant. And I know you are indeed brilliant. And we have Johnny Nyako says, go ahead, Mama Flora and Angel. And then Sumara comes and can say, great one, Dr. Thompson Hassan. What about those who cannot access or afford electricity? Those without the right tools to benefit from online learning. Great point. And Kokoya Javon says, beautiful work, Israel. We're learning a lot. Thank you very much. So I'm coming back to you. The kids, apparently you've all been making some fantastic points, and the people who are watching are appreciating what you have to say. Now, what are some of the things you'd want to see change? Later on, I'm going to come to Dr. Sandra, who's going to be telling us some of the things that you can do to keep yourselves sane whilst you're home. But I'd want to hear from you now. Talk to me again. And Christy, let's start with you, Christabel.
Yes. Please, may you repeat the question?
So essentially, what are some of the things you'd want to see change?
For me, it's definitely more communication for my online classes, because it's hard to communicate with the teachers. It's been very difficult.
What makes it difficult? Isn't it, you're supposed to be interacting and talking back?
We don't have like Zoom. We don't do the classes on Zoom. Yeah, live. They just give us work to do, and then like for me, if I don't understand the work, I have to try and contact my teacher and email them.
So you have to, you can only email. You don't have like a video session.
No. And that's what's made it for very difficult for me and stressful.
Well, those of us here in Ghana, we are lucky then. And so, yeah, Desmond doesn't get the benefit of online learning. I want to go back to him. Before then, DJ Switch. So it turns out that we are better off than some of the students in London.
Yeah. Well, as I was saying, everything has an advantage and a disadvantage, but we have an advantage of Google Classroom, also Zoom classes, and also the connection. What we'd like to change is going out there, like shops and malls providing masks, because you go to a mall and they'll be like, no mask, no entry. So what if I don't have the money to afford to buy a nose mask? Can't you give me the nose mask, like providing nose mask, and then also social distancing in some places? And also, I would also love that, you know, the public transport we have here in Ghana or anywhere does not have the Veronica buckets or soap and water to wash your hands. So, like, I would love to see that all of us go out with our soap, our tissues, and also hand sanitizer, something to clean our hands immediately we get down from public transport, because you may be tempted to touch your phone immediately you get down. And then obviously possibility of touching the seats are very high, and you don't know who sat on that seat. So I think I would love to see these things being changed.
All right, Ange, do you know what you have to do to keep yourself safe from COVID-19?
Yes, I do.
So you tell us about it.
After people lockdown has been lifted more and more here in Rwanda. So when you go out and come back, do not touch, immediately wash your hands. Even if you're staying somewhere, you shouldn't touch your card. Avoid as much as possible. And to avoid getting the virus, don't shake hands. If you have contact with the virus, call a medical professional, get yourself tested.
Okay, let me come to you, Angel, the other Angel. Angel, do you know what you have to do to keep yourself safe?
You have to wash your hands frequently. And if you don't have, and if you're not able to, you have to use sanitizer. And when you go out, you're supposed to wear a mask. But I believe that when you come home, instead of just washing your hands, you should take a bath, as I believe this will decrease the risk of you getting the disease.
Okay. And how about you? Let me go to Desmond again. Desmond, let's try. You know what you have to do to keep yourself safe.
Yes.
So tell us about it.
We don't need to go outside if you have. We don't need to go outside if you have nothing to do. And if it happens, if you go outside, if you meet our colleagues, we don't need to shake them. We don't need to shake hands with them. We just say hi and pass by. And we need to wash our hands thoroughly with soap and the running water, and use our sanitizers as often as we can. And always, we don't need to go to other areas. And we must always. And we must always observe all the protocols measures to fight against the COVID.
Well, Christabel, you haven't told us what the protocols are.
What do you mean?
Do you know the safety protocols as far as COVID is concerned? Do you know how to keep yourself safe?
Yeah, I know you have to stay 2 meters away from people. Wash your hands, always sanitize, wear a face mask when necessary, like going into the store or on public transport.
And from this week, no, from last week actually, you have to wear, it's compulsory to wear mask if you're going on public transport, if you're going to the shops. You have to, unless you are exempt, like medically exempt from wearing it, you have to put it on. But I do that anyway. We all do that. Apart from school, anywhere else, you have to put on mask.
Right. Prince David, do you know what the safety protocols are?
Okay. You need to wash your hands regularly with soap and the running water. And sanitize your hands with a sanitizer which contains 70% ethanol, and observe social distancing where you go out, because you don't actually know who carries the virus. And you also have to wear nose masks to protect yourself, because the disease can be transmitted through the air. It's actually an airborne disease, so you have to keep your nose masks on whenever you're going out, and you have to stay home. Yeah. Hello.
Yes. So staying with you, sometime this pandemic is going to be over. What's one of the very first things you'd love to do if you're free to do anything at all you want?
Yeah, actually, going to school or church or something. Like visiting my friends and
because I really do miss them. Yeah, it's actually been a long time. Yeah.
So how long has it been like for you? When was the last time you met with your friends to play with them?
Like 4 months ago.
And that's a really, really long time.
Yeah.
Okay, DJ Switch, what's one of the very first things you'd love to do once everything is fine and life is back to normal?
Well, go back to school. Well, here in Ghana, there's one thing that we are lucky to have. We can go to church, but it shouldn't be over 100 people in the church. And the time of 1 hour, but I think that there are some churches in some places no securities or something to check if they are overseeding the time. Number of people in the church are apt, so definitely going back to school.
During this period that you're home and you have to spend a lot of time at home, what are some of the things you're doing to keep yourself busy, DJ Switch?
Well, rehearsing, making playlists, anywhere by playlist, rehearsing, and then also doing online.
Okay, so the other person who we have in the webinar, who's an artist or who's also talented, is Ange Atete. Ange can sing so beautifully. Ange, if we have, and she's done a cover to a number of songs. So I think the two of you can connect. So Ange and DJ Switch, you can connect somehow. But Ange, are you in a position to just give us a musical interlude and get us to appreciate your talent? And one of the songs that you've done, the covers that you've done that I think is impressive, is The Perfect Song. Are you able to just do that for us now whilst we all get ourselves together and ready and to continue the conversation and talk about some of the things that you young people can do whilst you're home?
Yes.
Okay. So you're going to do The Perfect Song?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's all pay attention and see Ange go at it.
I found a love for me, darling, just dive right in, follow my lead. Well, I found a girl, beautiful and sweet. I never knew you were the someone waiting for me. Cause we were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time, darling, just kiss me slow. Your heart is all my own, and in your eyes, your hope to mine. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, while listening to our favorite song. When you said you looked a mess, I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it. Darling, you look perfect tonight.
Wow. That was lovely. That was lovely. Okay, so we're gonna, anybody else with talent, well, apart from DJ Switch, you're also gonna do something for us, right? DJ Switch, can you get your turntables ready to give us something? And you have your single out, right? You have a single.
Yeah.
So you probably will be telling us a bit more about that. Can you do something for us? I can give you some time to set up if you can, or we can do that before we end the show.
Now?
No, not immediately. Okay, so can we give you some time, maybe before we end the show in about 30 minutes? So you can go put yourself together.
Okay, I'll try and see.
Okay, all right. So, Whilst you go try, I want to go on to Dr. Sandra. Dr. Sandra, what are some of the things that the kids can do whilst they're home and to while away the time and or to make some good use of the time they have on their hands?
Okay, so to answer this question, I'll look at it from two angles here. You know, I told you earlier on, we have two groups of children here. So with those who are privileged, I will encourage parents to have a structure at home. A structure here is, for instance, having a timetable where, for example, if you are done with breakfast, the child will have to study. Afterwards, you can engage in your traditional games like Ludo, like Owari, any other game. And it's also a way of bonding with the kids. And then also, besides the games, there can be storytelling. You can also share your experiences with the kids so that they get to know more about who mommy or who daddy is. Also, another aspect too is the elder siblings could also help that of the younger ones at home in terms of studying. And then those who are unable to tune in or to access online learning or resources, you can also consider moving along with I think currently we have some stations that have been introducing teaching on their platforms. So you can also consider that. And then once a while, you can also consider taking a walk with your children outside home whilst observing or adhering to the protocols. And then one thing I'll quickly emphasize here too is the fact that a family member, a friend, or someone that you know might have been tested positive or even to an extent lose a life, like Dorcas's daughter, forgive me, I don't recall the name.
Christabel
said. In this case, I'll quickly want to ask Christabel, have you had any counseling to that effect?
No,
maybe
we did talk about it. Yeah, we did talk about it.
Okay, so perhaps Christabel might want to push it to the unconscious, but once a while it will surface. She might be traumatized in a way because you step out of the home, you are able to see the person's home. Where is she now? You become traumatized, and then you need to go through counseling so that they introduce therapies for you to overcome this. As well, you can also gain support, which already you are gaining from families and then friends. You talk through it. Talking to is a good therapy for you to heal. So this is mainly for those who are, let's say, privileged. Now I'm going back to my village, those without electricity. For them, I think NGOs, individuals who are in a position to help, government institutions can step in and then provide them with games. And then also they can give them storybooks to engage their thoughts before they get it rusted when school reopens. So I think these are few measures. And then also one other thing I'll say to us all here is that let's look through institutions also that are putting essential measures here. For instance, although we've not gotten to know whether school is reopening or not, my school, for instance, already have three measures in place that we are going to consider. So whether we are coming for the traditional or not, we already have measures in place. We need to take all these things in place, and then we need to actually discuss it all, reason through it with the kids at home.
All right, so whilst you were talking, Dr. Sandra, I have some of the comments coming through. So Kinziko says, Mother of All Nations Foundation will be running its Read Camp 2020 COVID-19 edition. to improve the reading skills of young people, what unique thing do you think we can inculcate into the project to make it more impactful, Dr. Sandra?
Okay, so for now, I don't know much of what they do, but then if they have a psychologist on board, or they can even team up, currently GPA as part of their social responsibility, they are offering free counseling, free support for people who have been tested positive or people who are traumatized. And in fact, Israel, when I'm done, I'll send you the link so that maybe you share it to people who would want to call them. It's for free. They have counselors, they have renowned clinical psychologists on board. So they can also team up with them and see how best they can help the children out there.
All right, and then I have Kwame Apia Kubi. He says, the children, as a further step to improve themselves at home, should develop new things, new concepts to improve their skills and talent. We've just witnessed a great talent. Children make good use of the time at home. So Kwame Apia Kubi, this goes to you, the children. He's saying that make good use of the time you have at home. So develop a talent. You may have something that you're probably not aware of, but yes, if you take your time to develop these talents, you could probably make something of it later on in the future. Lord Thompson says, quite amazing to hear from these kids their perspective of social life. Parents ought to leverage on this to broaden their scope along with academic life. So we've been talking about talents and what the kids can do for the period that they are home. And I want to come to you, the kids, and you tell us, Prince David Ofori, I want to start with you. Is there something, some talent, or some way you want to use the time at home that you want mommy to support you to get to do that?
Okay. Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Hello? We can hear you.
Okay. I actually do love to play the piano a lot. I can see it's actually a talent, and I love to play it. And whenever I play the piano, like, I feel okay. I feel all right. So when I actually, when I'm
so
actually
right there,
free,
you have a talent there, right? Do you have your keyboard close enough so that you can play us something before we end?
Please, no. I really, it's really faulty, but it's okay this time.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, but great. So what advice do you have to give to the other kids, your peers, those who are watching you?
Okay, I would advise them to stay safe. And the fact that the schools have been closed doesn't change. The schools being closed doesn't change the fact that we are students. And as students, there's something we have to do in order to keep moving in life. So as kids, we should keep educating ourselves. And we should receive advice from our parents, if possible. And we should do the right thing and stay safe.
All right, I come to you, Angel. So Angel, you tell us, is there any talent that you have that you would want to explore that you need mommy to help you to do that?
Yeah, I'm very good with playing brass instruments. At school, I was in the school band.
That's great. That's good. Okay, so you'd want to develop that a lot further?
Yes.
Where would you want to take it eventually? Do you want to join DJ Switch and Ange and Rwanda and Prince David so that you guys can put together a band or something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe.
Okay, sure. But I mean, this is your opportunity. Like, as we've heard, this is your opportunity to try and hone your talents. Let me go to Desmond and see if we can get him to get to speak. So Desmond, you tell us, are there any talents that you would want to hone that or probably have some hidden talents that you can share with us? Exhibit. Yeah, so Desmond, you haven't had the opportunity to speak much, so when I give you the opportunity, you can say as much as you want to say. I want to ask you, what can be done, or what would you rather would want to see happen to improve your situation as far as learning is concerned? Let's start there.
How?
Desmond, what is that one thing? Okay, let me make it personal. Desmond, is there anything that I can do to support you to improve your online learning?
Yes.
So tell me about it. How would you want me to support you?
I will need a laptop.
You need a laptop?
Yes.
Okay. So with a laptop, what exactly would you be doing when you have it?
I will join an online group.
Okay.
Study with them.
Would that help if, would it help if you had a phone?
Yes.
Okay. So, yes. I'll see what I can do about that for you, Desmond.
Okay.
All right. Great. And let me come. But is there any talent you want to share with us?
Yes. Me, I'm good in football. But
oh, okay. Yeah, tell us about the football.
But it's a contact sport, so it's not good in this period. Because of the COVID.
You can play football very well?
Yes.
Okay. That's great. Good to hear. So we're hoping that sometime very soon it will be possible for us to be out there free so you can play your sport. Thankfully, I've just been joined by Dr. Chris O. We're hoping to have had him join us at the beginning of the program, but he's joined us. So it's not too late. Now, Dr. Chris Owu, we are glad to have you. I want you to tell us about children who have had COVID and how they're having to cope. Because a lot of people just think that COVID affects adults. But we know that there are some children who have had COVID as well. So you tell us about that experience.
Hi, good afternoon, Israel. Good afternoon, everyone. Apologies, I had to join later. I actually thought I was joining earlier and then would exit early. But we've been busy in the intensive care unit. I'm actually at the University of Ghana Medical Center intensive care unit for COVID-19 patients. And we've been a bit busy inside, and that's why it took me a while. Yeah, Israel. Yes, COVID affects everyone of all ages. Thankfully, the children have not been as infected as most of the adults are and have not been as severe as most of the adults are. The statistics we see from every country in the world and including in our country is that the infection among children is much less. Much less. And I'll give you examples. We've had situations where we had to admit families where the mother, the father are positive for COVID, and then we admit them to isolation or treatment centers. And these are people who have very young children, and sometimes we are forced to actually admit them with the children because they have nobody to take care of them. On a number of these families, most of the children were negative at the time of admission. And at the time the family had spent the time in isolation in our treatment centers and were leaving and their parents were tested to be negative, the children were still negative. And I said very thankfully, because it would have been disastrous, because if we're trying to do social distancing among very little kids or getting 1 year olds, 1.5 year old to wear mask, you can imagine what that means. I have an 18 month old boy, and to get him to sit in one place, you can imagine how difficult that is. So it hasn't been as the infection rate in children is definitely much lower than adults. Now, what about severe illness? Again, thankfully, most of the children who have gotten COVID-19 had been totally asymptomatic or just occasional flu-like symptoms, still able to run about, maybe a little headache here, a little fever there, but majority of them have not required significant periods of admission for treatment, let alone ICU. All right, having said that, we have still had children who have been admitted with COVID-19 to intensive care units. And we have lost a few children also who had died from infection with COVID-19 or consequences, later consequences of COVID-19. So there had been a 9-year-old in Ghana who was admitted in our hospital in Kolibu, and then who actually died from COVID-19 severe or critical illness. Majority of the others do quite very well. We've had for Ghana, the remarkable one we had is 11-year-old who was admitted into ICU and spent almost 40 days in ICU as a consequence of COVID-19. Now, what we should be mindful while we are happy that children are not as affected as adults is that just as we said in adults, if you have other disease conditions, COVID-19 can make it worse. It can make it even critical. And in children, sometimes they may have conditions that we're not aware of just because they haven't grown old enough for us to find out. And we know about heart issues. We know there are children who will find out that they are sickle cell later in life. There are people with asthma and other conditions. Now, there is this phenomenon that has been demonstrated quite a lot in Europe. And in UK, there are papers out about what looks like a hyperinflammatory. And when I say hyperinflammatory, it's basically rapid progressive critical illness in children with COVID-19. They call it a Kawasaki-like syndrome. It's a cytokine storm. It basically means that the child develops a high fever, and then that is followed by other things that may affect the brain, the lungs, and all that. And that is quite lethal. There's been quite a number of reports of that from UK and a few other European countries. We don't think we have had one of those yet, but we've had other conditions that are triggered by viral infections, like paralysis. Guillain-Barre is one of those where the child totally become paralyzed from basically neck down and unable to move the upper limbs or the lower limbs because the virus triggers an immune response, basically your own body to fight your body. And we already had that from other viral infections, other flu-like infections previously. And then we have had one of that in Ghana, and the 11-year-old I talked about actually developed Guillain-Barre, which was precipitated by COVID-19 virus. And she managed together with the pediatricians in Kolibu Teaching Hospital and the pediatric intensive care. At a point in time, we had to move her to UGMC, ICU, and continue working with the pediatricians. She was on a ventilator for 30 days in UGMC, 30 days on life support. The good thing is she survived. She got off the ventilator. She got back to Kolibu. She's been discharged home. She's having fistula. Now, because children have a lot better reserve than we, the adults, they tend to do better even for conditions that may be difficult for adults to survive. And that's been our experience. Now, as I said earlier on, percent, it may be 0.1%. If it is your child who is affected and who dies, it's actually 100%. It feels like 100% for your family. And that is why we say that it is important to still protect the children, irrespective of how low the infection rate is among them. It is important to protect them from severe illness and to look out for it if anybody in the family is infected among the children. Then you reduce the chance of your child becoming one of the statistics when we talk about mortality from COVID-19. So hand washing is important, teach your children. My 18-month-old boy now knows how to rub sanitizer on his hand and round the hand because he sees daddy and mommy do that very often. They learn by watching what we do. If they see us wearing our masks, the 5-year-olds would be happier to wear the masks. If they see us maintaining a decent distance from each other and then making sure that we wash our hands regularly, it becomes their habit. Then they will grow up being a better generation than our generation is at the moment, where now we are grappling with this because it was not generally part of our psyche as a people. But then we develop a cleaner, a more hygienic generation in our children as they grow up. Then we have a better chance with infections like this when it happens when they are the main generation. Yeah.
Yes. All right. Dr. Chris, so I have a number of the parents and kids wanting to ask you questions. So we're going to open the floor and get them to ask you questions. I want to start with you, Dorcas.
Yes, I wanted to find out how effective taking vitamin C and cod liver capsules with vitamin A and D are towards COVID-19.
All right. Thank you, Dorcas. And nice having you you both on this. This is quite remarkable. So first of all, let me say that vitamin C, D, cod liver oil and the other supplements are not medicines that treat COVID-19 virus. They are not antiviral. They do not kill viruses. Okay, so, and I need everybody else to understand that. So we, if not, we would actually be better off by now, basically treating everybody with that method. But what they do is that they help with basically balancing the nutrients that our body needs in clearing toxic substances. So we call some of these antioxidants or antitoxic agents. They help to some extent with our immune system. And therefore, when we get infections or when we get viruses attacking us, we have a stronger defense mechanism to fight them. It's the same reason that we say people should eat well, balanced diet, a lot of vegetables and fruits. Now, what we are doing with the vitamin C, the zinc, the vitamin D, the cod liver oil, is actually give you a more concentrated form of that so that you don't have to drink 10 oranges a day, especially for those who don't know how nice that orange is going to taste. So that's basically what grow the play, that they help make you stronger immune-wise, but not because they are anti-COVID treatment. It means that then we are able to handle this and other infections, and it's not only for COVID. If you notice, when we have flu, we are told to drink vitamins even before COVID-19, or to drink a lot of water and drink some oranges or tangerine or lemon. It's the same concept here, that this helps with preparing our body. So if you have this already in your body and you're eating well, but then let me sound a caution, because there are people who are basically taking tablets, chewing vitamin C, zinc all over the place, but they're not taking good care of themselves and they're not eating well. They are refusing to eat their carrots. They are refusing to eat their veggies. I'm sure she's listening. And then they think that that will do all the work. It's just one of the nutrients. We still need to eat balanced diet, a good protein, some carbohydrates. This will get you some minerals and vitamins that you need. And then that will help you fight them. Then, of course, you have to wash your hands. If not, if you are chewing vitamin C and chewing the COVID viruses on the, with the other lips, at a point in time, it's going to override the vitamin C.
Yeah, certainly. All right, so do we have anybody else having a question for Dr.? Okay, so let's go to you, DJ Switch.
My question is, I was told that the incubation period for COVID-19 is up to 14 days, and the average is 5 to 6 days. And then before those days, after those days, you feel the symptoms of COVID-19. Does it mean that if you are being infected with the COVID-19 and the incubation period is, it's not time for the incubation period to end, you won't feel symptoms of COVID-19?
All right, DJ Switch. I have followed you from a distance. Maybe from today, I'm your official follower, isn't it? Okay, so good question, good question. Now, so when we talk about incubation period, when an infection that harbors our body, enters our body, they usually will pass through the ports that they come through, go into our body, and then play around with the organs and the systems in our body. And then when our body's immune system recognizes them, they come back out. And after they have multiplied, because these viruses are not full organisms on their own. They are components of what usually would form a cell. So they are not even, we call it an RNA virus, because it hasn't got a full complement. So it needs a host for it to be able to multiply. If it doesn't multiply, it's not going to get into somebody else. So it gets into us, it goes into our system. Our system accepts it, thinking that, oh, okay, I can be friend with this guy. And then what happens is that then it starts multiplying in our cells. And then it can come out for us to give it to somebody else. And it's during that process that is doing that we call incubation period, where it sits tight, begging to be let in, behaves like the good guy, and then after some time become the demon that we don't want it to be. Now, if it hasn't gone through that incubation period to come out to be able to infect other people, we are not able to infect. You may be able to show some non-specific symptoms when it's going through the processes, okay? But usually not quite a lot. But what is important is that we say up to 14 days, but it's not 14 days in everybody. We've seen it take about 4 days in some people, and average about 5 to 6 days, as you correctly said. So it may have a shorter incubation period on some, it may have a longer incubation period. The important thing about incubation period is that you would, if he hasn't gone through that period, you would test negative. So if I test you now, you got infected with, let's say, the virus yesterday, and he hasn't gone through his incubation period, you'll be negative. But that does not mean that you have not been infected. But because of the test we are doing, it's actually trying to pick what has gotten incubated and come back to your airway where it can affect other people, you will be negative. Now, and that's why usually if you have a contact with somebody who is positive and we test you and you're negative, we tell you that you are not yet negative until we test you in another 14 days, at which point in time you have gone through the whole stretch, even if your incubation period takes 14 days. Now, usually by the time you are showing positive, you may or may not have symptoms. As I said, it's not everybody who gets symptoms. Okay, so symptoms are not the evidence to show that you can infect somebody. Symptoms usually means that if you have been infected, you will test positive. But there are people who may not have symptoms and then who can still infect. So if you are looking out for your classmates who has symptoms to show evidence that, oh, I should socially distance from this person, you're going to get it wrong. Because the person may have finished the incubation period, is able to infect, but the body, the person was chewing vitamin C, was chewing, eating well, and the body has dealt with it very nicely. So the social distance is not only for those who are coughing, or against only those who are coughing. It's not only with respect to those who have a flu-like symptom. It's for everybody, whether they have tested or not, whether they have symptoms or not.
Okay. So, right, Jenipher, you also have a question for Dr. Owu.
Yes, Israel. I want to thank you for inviting the doctor, and I have a few questions to ask. One of them I think is just answered now. There's so many theories around this virus, and one of them is that people who live in hot environments like ours, let's say, not severe coldness, that they don't tend to be affected so much by this virus as compared to those who live in very extreme cold weather. So I wanted to ask you, Doctor, if this theory is true. Right now we are seeing so many deaths happening in Nairobi, and this is the time of the year when Nairobi is really very cold. Same with Malawi. And of course, we've had those deaths in the US and UK. So I was trying to get convinced that probably it has something to do with the weather. And the other thing is that, is it possible that this virus can go through you and you don't notice it? It can come and pass without you noticing that you have it. Of course, on the issue of the weather also is related to vitamin D, because I've heard some doctors on social media saying that those who have like insufficient vitamin D, that this virus affects so much than those who have exposure to vitamin D, and they were encouraging people to have vitamin D supplements. So how far through is that? And is it also, in your own analysis, of course there is touching hands and also there is wearing masks. Right now, of course, the lockdown is easing up and we find ourselves going for these meetings and we put on masks. But in between, we have a tendency of putting down the mask, but we don't touch each other. I just wanted to know, between shaking hands or touching one another, and then you touch yourself, and then the coming through a close in distance with someone who has it. Which one also, what advice would you give to someone, because we've had prevention measures, but it's rare that we hear advice to someone who has just been contracted with COVID-19, other than going to the hospital and then you just have this anxiety. What advice would you give to someone who has just contracted with the, or who has just tested positive with COVID-19, even if this person may not be having symptoms? Sorry, I've asked many questions.
Yeah, I know. It's okay. So, Dr. Owu, so we have a number of questions for you. So please take as many as you can.
All right. So let me start off with the... So I got the weather one. Okay. So I got their advice. I got the hand hygiene. There was one more that was... come again.
Is the vitamin D related?
Yes. So vitamin D. Okay. All right. So let me start off with the weather, because we are all in sub-Saharan Africa. The weather in Ghana is not much different from Kenya. And greetings to Nairobi, greetings to Kenya.
Rwanda.
All right. So now, so it's not wholly true that the temperature determines the survival, where will be affected by the virus, okay? So let me say that coronaviruses, which is one of the family that the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID virus, COVID-19 virus belongs to, has always been here, even in Africa. So there are other coronaviruses. It's not the first coronavirus we have in, but the others had been related to common flu in children and some dysenterial diseases, okay? So we've had them. So something coming from that same family, it's a bit weird to think that it cannot happen in Africa. Now, what we know is that because of our weather and then surfaces and all that, the ones that are dropping on surfaces may last. These are very fragile viruses, so they do not last as long as they would last in places where the temperature is very temperate and very cold. So their infection may end up lasting longer in the environment to infect other people than in our part of the world when the sun is up. Okay, the sun burns things easily. So if you sneeze or cough into the environment here, when the sun is very hot up, the virus wouldn't last as long as it will in a very cold, temperate region in Europe or in the Americas. So that we know of. And that probably is part of the reason it was much slower. But obviously, it's obvious to us that we have been as affected as almost everywhere else. China stabilized at tens of thousands. Ghana, we entered 30,000. We are higher than a number of countries in Europe, which are more temperate than us. South Africa has over 400,000 reported cases as we speak now. Yes, I know parts of South Africa are cold, but there are parts of South Africa which is as hot as Kenya and Ghana. So yes, the virus is fragile, does not last long outside the body. Majority of its transmission is basically directly coughing and sneezing and then getting into somebody else. And it will get the appropriate environment for it to grow and then multiply. Or touching surfaces, and that's where the handshake came in quite quickly. Because especially in Africa, we have a culture that touch a lot. We basically express our emotions, we express our relationship, we touch, we shake hands, we have different ways of shaking hands and all that. And we know that if you don't have multiple access to clean your hand multiple times, that means you are basically transferring to somebody who is going to rub his eye or rub his nose or put something in his mouth. It's a short period of time, and that gives the virus entrance into you. So that's why the distancing gives us distance so that it does not travel far enough. Because when we cough and when we sneeze, we require about 1 to 2, at least more than 1 meter for it to, we require less than 1 meter distance for us to transfer it to somebody else. So when we put that distance more than 1 meter in between us, even when we cough, it drops in between us. Okay, and that helps. And that's why the masking and then the hand hygiene is helping. Now, vitamin D is quite a lot in our environment, even in the rainy season, because we still have the sun, even in the rainy season in sub-Saharan Africa. And that's helped a lot from what we've seen in our patients who are walking about. We try to not only lock them and lock people up in isolation, we create places for them to come out and then interact and then get some fresh air and some morning sunlight. And that helps a lot. Yes, there are people who are walking about who have the virus, but they do not show any symptoms. And that is actually the majority of people who are infected. And that's why we keep saying that the protocols, hand hygiene, mask, and then the distancing, both physical and social, helpful, because yes, majority of people who get a virus can have the virus without showing any symptoms, without falling ill at all.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Oh. We have a Flora also wanting to ask a question. So Flora, let's hear you.
Okay, Doc, my question is that how long does it take for someone that has tested positive and showing all the symptoms to recover? The reason why I'm asking this question is that when we take the situation we have in Ghana here, every day you check the stats and it's like, as the number of cases keeps on increasing, the recovery rate also increases. And okay, is there a correlation between the two? Let me put it that way.
All right, Doc.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, so let me explain to you why you're seeing that. No, so first of all, yeah, it takes roughly about 14 days, 10 to 14, 11 to 14 days, even from data from our country, for somebody who's tested positive to recover from the virus. Now, recovering from the virus means that the virus is no longer either in you and cannot be transmitted to somebody else. That is different from recovering from illness, because if you have a severe illness, the virus may go out of you, but the consequence of what it has done to your body may take quite longer for you to recover. So, for example, the young lady who was in the ICU for over 30 days, at halfway through her time, she was negative, but she had had severe injuries to her body from the virus. So we had to wait for clinically for her to recover from those other injuries. Now, so it basically means after about 14 days, we deem that we are not able to infect other people. Why are recoveries also going up as our number of cases go up? Because basically about 14 days, especially for those who have no symptoms, we will declare you discharged from isolation because we know that you are not able to infect other people. Now, a number of the results we're seeing are coming in sometime because there have been lab delays, sometimes after about a week after the sample was actually taken. And therefore it means that the person may have just basically about a week for us to declare, because the 14 days is calculated from when the lab is taken, or when if they had symptoms and were admitted to a treatment center, when their symptoms stopped or resolved. Okay, so you may actually have people whose results are coming when they officially should have been discharged. We've had at some point in time people who were receiving their result 3 weeks down the line, they would have recovered by that time. The danger with those lab results is that if the lab results come late, the people do not get opportunity to isolate and prevent them from infecting other people. And that's why our labs, Noguchi and the others, are working feverishly to make sure that we get results much more early. I think nowadays the results are quite coming in quite quicker, because if not, yes, you are recovered or discharged, but then you may have infected 10 other people who infect another 10 other people because they do not know. Okay, so that's why you see what you're saying.
Okay, all right. So I don't have any other hand up, so I'd want to think that everybody has asked their question, which will take us to DJ Switch. So Dr. Owu, DJ Switch is going to be performing for us, doing something for us.
Yeah.
So do stand by for that. But I want to go to Dr. Sandra to give us her final thoughts so we can recap, because we've gone past the 1 o'clock we're supposed to end the webinar. So Dr. Sandra, you wrap up for us.
Okay, well, what I want to quickly chip in is that schools hopefully might reopen. And then the question here is that what are the measures that we've put in place? I'm going to encourage parents to contact the various schools and then question them as to the measures they put in place to ensure that their children are really safe. Also, I will advise schools out there or teachers out there, or I mean principals or heads of schools, to orient teachers especially. They should be able to provide some form of support for our children. And then they should be able to make referrals where relevant as to suspected cases. And then also, someone tells me, before COVID, we're already coughing. So if someone coughs, doesn't mean you should just quickly distance yourself from the person. And if someone coughing, doesn't mean the person already has the virus. So as much as possible, we should encourage children to maintain calm and not to panic in any ways. And then we should also do our very best to link up our children with facilities where necessary to receive some form of counseling as to how they should be at peace in these times and how they should move forward. And then I think lastly, I'll just, like I mentioned earlier, we should contact Ghana Psychological Association and then just placing calls to speak with clinical and then counseling psychologists to seek for some of this help, because like I said, it's actually free. And then lastly, I'll just say that parents, too, as much as possible, you can also chip in a word or two to suggest to the various schools as to how we should move forward in case we are going the traditional way.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Sandra. So DJ Switch says she has one more question to ask. So DJ Switch, you ask your question before you play us out.
My question is, we know that there is no cure for COVID-19, but the recoveries keep rising, and I want to know, how is it just the isolation that recovers those who have been infected?
Right, Dr. Wu.
Yes, so DJ Switch. So the recoveries keep rising because for viral flus, just like other flus, if you do not get complications from it, you will recover. The virus will leave your body alone eventually. So our body also has a way of fighting, even when we don't give it medication to fight. And that's why we have to live a healthy life. So our bodies are taking care of the viruses for those who do not have symptoms and those who have mild disease. And usually within 14 days of testing positive, majority of them will recover and the virus will leave them alone. We are working on finding vaccines and treatments like as we've already have for other infections, and then that will make it easier for us. But that's why we are having recoveries, that people are actually recovering. Over 90% of people who have been infected in our country and other African countries are actually not having severe conditions and they are recovering. But make sure you're not among that 2% who require to come to an ICU. By taking good care of yourself, by trying not to get infected, by washing your hands, by using the sanitizers, by modeling same for your friends, and then peers basically talking among each other about how this can be helpful. And then we probably will have a healthier population. And we'll continue this when COVID leaves, to have healthy ways of life, washing our hands. Now, it's easier to get people to wash their hands and to follow the cough etiquettes.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Chris. So that's some very good advice there. And I'd like to say thank you to all of you who have participated in this webinar for making time to join us. And your questions, your contributions have been very insightful. Now, we're going to leave DJ Switch to play us out. Yes,
just before DJ Switch, I'll just step back because I've removed my mask to do so that my colleagues who've been working 13 stretch hours in the ICU, Emma, Nimako, Sarah, are here in the ICU with me.
Let's see them.
A quick hello.
So let's see them.
Hey, Israel.
Hi, hello. Dr. Emma, how are you?
I'm fine, Izzy. How are you?
I'm good too. Great job. Keep up with the good work, okay?
Hey, thanks.
Okay, so.
Hello, Israel.
Hiya.
Dr. Nimako.
I'm Dr. Nimako.
Okay, Dr. Nimako, thank you very much for the great work that you're all doing. We're all happy and pleased with the work you're doing, and we just want to say thank you.
Hello, Israel.
Yes.
I'm Sarah.
All right. So thank you too. You're all doing a great job. Okay. So DJ Switch is going to play a song for all of you. So just stay tuned. DJ Switch, you take over.
The way you move your body, me alive, yeah. Y'all come right on my bike, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Miss Philly saying that who's something will make me feel it.
DJ Switch.
Bossy. Godfather, man a OG. Man a half humble, man a bossy. Fling a rag a rhythm like it's all free. Bossy, house on the coast G. My money so long it doesn't know me. It's looking at my kids like I'm bossy. Hey,
yo, AJ,
make
the
don't rush.
Slow Dutch, brown and white. Like a go country, grab and buy. We can go bust, eye for eye. They can lose trust. White rum, fizzy pop. Where you they go? With the go up. Catch my vibe. Let me go off. Blam the trash. Man, it's so tough.
Alright, yo, put the belly on the body, make a clutch. Team will watch, now she wanna give crutch. Boy got peas, now she's hopping in the pod. Man, a real life sugar girl, I'm not gonna get what. She ain't got to me, she ain't got to she ain't got to play after the world.
DJ Switch! And this time around, I'm gonna see the dog.
DJ Switch.
To fall in love. I'm beginning to begin to fall in love. I'm beginning to begin to fall in love.
The Swag DJ, DJ Switch. DJ Switch.
We go chop life. We go make eye. Also, we go carry.
Okay. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much, DJ Switch.
DJ Switch.
All right, and thank you to you all. You have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Israel.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.